ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ralphie May.
What's going on, everybody? Wow. Awesome. Rock and roll. That's fantastic. That's a... Hi, everybody. Thank you. Thank you guys for coming out. I appreciate it. Awesome. Calm down. Damn, I'm gonna be here a while. It's great to be here. I'm actually just giving y'all a couple of moments to get used to the amount of orange on stage. Y'all like, damn, he really loves his orange juice, don't he? I look like I'm under construction, don't I? I like it, baby. I'm a pro vitamin C. It's great to be here. Y'all don't know this. I just had a baby. Thank you very much. I know. My wife did. I used my mighty wand of Jesus and planted my seed deep into her uterus. And, ta-da. Baby. It was awesome, man. Her name is April June May. She's a beautiful little girl. Yeah, that's her real name, I know. try to forget it, bet you can't. Try to forget it. She's adorable. It cracks me up. All my buddies, y'all are handling a lot better than my friends. My friends are like, dude, that's a stripper name, dude. I'm like, no, it's not. Watch your mouth, okay? It's my baby. Whatever, dude, that's a stripper name. Really? No, strippers don't give themselves cute little names like April, June, May. They give themselves names after cars they can't afford, like Lexus and Mercedes and Chrysler 300. She's a big girl, works over in Detroit. I don't know if you've been to Detroit. She drops it like a Tonto. That's what matters. She's awesome. Everybody always asks me, though, the same question every time. Dude, how in the world did your wife let you name her that? Let me. I filled out the paperwork, okay? she had her legs up in the air and her vagina was wrecked, okay? I filled it in, okay? It could have been daddy's got a big crank. It could have been anything, you know? I could have named her anything. I like April June May, man. It's awesome. I love being a daddy. It was tough for me because my second choice after April June May was C Block. For the name for my baby, because she's the biggest sex stopper I've ever endured, ever. My wife is beautiful, hot little Jew broad, who before the pregnancy would love to catch a stabbing. I mean, twice a day. Loved getting her legs put up. It was awesome. And, once in the morning out of respect for the sun, and then... Once in the evening, so everybody can sleep nice, all right? What do you want? As soon as that other line showed up on the test, she shut the monkey down. I mean, shut it down. Nothing ever, okay? And she got mad, too. I mean, mad. Like, all the time, angry, like, you did this to me, you son of a bitch, you fat bastard, you did this to me, you made me fat, my mom was right, fat is contagious. That's not cool. All the time. I couldn't do nothing right. I could never do anything right. And you think normal Jew broads bitch a lot? Oh, no. Try a Jew broad who's growing a whole nother Jew broad in her. That's the square root of bitching right there, friends. You can't get away from it. I finally, after 4 months of the same ear beating day in and day out, how I'm wrong and I can't do anything right, I finally just snapped. And I'm like, she's like, you did this to me. And I'm like, you know what, bitch? You had some options, okay? You could have taken it on the face, okay? Just look at it. Help it. Help it. Only you can save my penis. I was trying, man. God. I tell you the truth, I should be arrested for what I had to do to myself over the past year. I abused my junk. Oh my God. It was a second degree assault a couple of times. I pummeled it. My junk had a callus and a limp. It was. It looked like Rocky in the 14th round. Like, I couldn't even reach for change in my pocket without my penis wincing. No, 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 no. See, it was a dangerous thing, is that I had the knowledge of a man in his 30s with the desire and the enthusiasm of an eighth grader. That's a very dangerous combination. It was brutal. I used every masturbatory kung fu I'd ever heard of. Old school, doggy style, fire starter. Pepper grinder. Kawasaki dirt bike. Ring, 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 ring. And those are common knowledge, okay, now as an adult. I mean, you can look them up on the internet. They're there. They're bona fide. This one I think I might have invented. I'm not sure. I'm not taking full credit. I can't trademark it, but I think I got it. I call it the ketchup. When you bring out the ketchup, your junk knows you mean business, okay? One time, 11 times in one day. Oh my God, I broke a record, shattered a record that had stood for 21 years. Shattered. I was close. You know, you get to like, you know, you're like the last five, you're like, I only got five more to go. The last three were just air. It was like, I got lied to by my friends that have had babies, and all my guy friends told me the same lie over and over and over again. Dude, there's gonna be like a 3-month period during the pregnancy where it's nothing but sex. Really? Yeah, that's a lie, okay? That should start off with once upon a time, all right? Because it's a lie. I was getting blanked. And it was weird because I was enthusiastic about being a father. You know, I had my calendar out and I wrote in everything that was happening every week in the baby's life, a big wall calendar right by my side of the bed. And it was like, you know, this week I lost my tail, my lungs are developing, I can see, you know, I'm getting fingers, okay, you know, all this cool stuff, right? And I was looking through it and it was strange because every day I'd wake up, I'd pop the top on a big red marker and I'd be like, hey honey, you feel like some sex today? Screw you, you fat son of a bitch, you rat bastard, you made me fat and pregnant, you son of a. And I looked at the calendar and I was at the 8th month, okay? I'd gotten blanked for 8 months. I'm in the 8th inning, okay? And she's pitching a perfect game, okay? I can't go out like that. I decided to seduce my wife. I was flying in from New York, okay? And I took that's a 6-hour flight, all right? And it takes an hour to get to the airport, you have to be there an hour early, all right? So that's 8-hour day before I had to come home and assemble things. If you're a new father, the last month of the pregnancy, all you do is put stuff together. And by the way, so everybody knows, if you hand me a toy for a gift for my baby that requires assembly, I'm re-gifting it. I'm giving it to somebody else. It is not worth the effort or the drama to put it together. If the Mexican at the store can't put it together, What makes you think I can put it together? Extra parts, you know, stuff's put together by tape. Not good. All my wife had to do was drive 35 minutes from our house to LAX and pick me up. That's all she had to do. Sleep in late, drive 35 minutes, pick me up. That's it. Okay, I land, she picks me up, and as soon as we get in the car, it just starts, the ear beating. You fat bastard making me drive all the way down here to LAX. I almost died 3 times, you son of a bitch. I can't believe you're so insensitive. Don't think I'm doing your laundry, because I'm not. I'm pregnant, damn it, and I can't lift your pants. They're fat as shit, and you're big, all right? It's like a cape. She told me my pants were like a cape. Now, in my mind, I'm thinking, I ought to punch this bitch in the face. But you don't do it. You never do it. You never act about it. But that's like natural Prozac. As a man in the relationship, it makes you feel better to know that you might need to punch that bitch in the face. Just thinking about it, you're like, she was griping. What she did not know is I'd set up a 5-hour spa appointment for her at her favorite spa in Los Angeles. Yeah, 5 hours. I got her a manicure, a spa manicure, a spa pedicure, a massage, a facial, and something called a body polish. And I don't even know what body polish is. I think it might be like a female rub and tug. I'm not sure. But I don't care. Some little Asian guy comes in there and, you know, plays centipede on her junk. I'm happy. Get the scorpion. I don't care. I'm married. As long as she comes back happy, good. But I didn't tell her, okay? So we just pull up and she's still nagging. And I just turned to her and first words I've said the whole ride, besides yes, ma'am, and of course. I just turned to her and I go, get out. My bitch, and I'm so sorry, and I'm all emotional and hormonal. Oh my God, I'm just big as a house. Oh, I'm so sorry. You're not kicking me out, are you? No, look where we're at. We're at your favorite spa. Get out. I got you 5 hours of spa appointments. Enjoy. Oh my God, really? You got me feel the greatest husband in the whole world. You love me so much. But that's so expensive. 5 hours. Oh my God, that's gonna cost so much money. Oh my God. Well, it's a good thing I make a lot of money. Now get out. Quit being such a Jew. All right? Beat it. By the way, don't think that I'm anti-Semitic, okay? All right? I mean, I hate when people say that because they're so conditioned nowadays to be reactionary, okay? You know, they're like, ooh, he's anti-Semitic. Really? Really? I'm so anti-Semitic, I married a Jew, we made a Jew. I think I'm doing the work of Christ over here, okay? Relax. And you get all sensitive and worked up. All right, beat it. And she's like, okay, if you want me to go to the spa, I guess I'll go. Really? Tuck and roll. Get the hell out of the car. You can only have this conversation with a woman. Only a woman will look a gift and be upset about it. Like, okay, if you're gonna make me take that gift, I guess I'll take it. Like, if I went to my with my buddy Jimmy to a strip club, and we went to a strip club, and I pulled up in front of it, and I go, dude, I just got you 5 hours of lap dances. Enjoy. Before I got enjoy out of my mouth, Jimmy be like, later, player. There'll be no hesitation. What she did not know also is I had a cleaning crew up at the house cleaning the house. You want to get women hot, make it a clean house, Jack. All right, especially if it's your wife. That's right. I had 7 Mexicans cleaning that son of a bitch like nobody's business. And I think we all here in Texas know how clean Mexicans can get a house. They're awesome. They're awesome. Now, I am bragging a little bit. We're not actually rich enough to get 7 bona fide Mexicans. Our Mexicans are from El Salvador. Isn't that really splitting hairs, though? I think so, isn't it? Really? Ain't no racial pun intended, but literally the house was spick and span. The weather in Los Angeles is weird, you know? It was like August and it was 50 degrees outside. So to complete the trifecta, I had built my wife a fire because she's a woman that's never been warm enough. Okay, and she loves a fire. It was only like 50 degrees, but she's like, oh my God, I love it. Oh my God, I love it. It's so romantic. You're the greatest. I'm sorry. But while she's saying all that, I'm standing in front of the refrigerator looking for popsicles to put underneath my titties. I'm like, Lord. I'll skip through a bunch of the romantic stuff, okay? But, let's just say I was about 30 strokes in, right? And if you've ever made love to a woman that's carrying your child as a man, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's a different type of experience. It's not your regular sex. It's something emotional on like multiple levels you're hitting all at once. And it just really worked me up. It was amazing. And you know, I looked down at my beautiful wife, the vessel of my unborn child, and I realized this is all I need. That this woman is amazing. I mean, for the first 6 years of our relationship, I never had a comma in my bank account. And she stayed with me. We lived in a crappy studio apartment in West Hollywood, all right, and she stayed with me. She was there when I was selling weed. She was there when the IRS came knocking. She was there. She was there. She was there. And I realized that they could take away everything, the houses, the cars, everything. As long as I got everything right here is all I need, all right? And I guarantee without my wife, nobody here would know who I am, all right? She's that important. And this is all I needed. And you have this emotion. And my wife is the direct opposite of me. She's a little stick, okay? And when she was 8 months pregnant, she just looked like a snake that swallowed a basketball. It was brutal. All baby. And as soon I was looking down at her, and my child, April, she ran her face across the inside of my wife's stomach like, ah. And I'm like, ah. I'm done. Is it because I'm fat? No, it's because I don't like threesomes, all right? This is creepy. Creepy. And I've seen the movie Aliens, and I think I'm about to be killed. Well, can we just try again? No. This is a C block I cannot recover from, okay? This ain't like the phone ringing or somebody knocking on the door. You can't get back into the moment. I tell you, in 3 months, when the vagina comes back online, I'll be there, all right? But once your child, by the way, gives you the mummy in the sandstorm, it's over. I'm tapping out. The worst part about my wife being pregnant was traveling. I had to go to Denver. I went through, if you ever have to go through Denver, drive. Don't fly. Denver Airport is one of the worst airports in the country, okay? It's hot garbage. I hate Denver Airport, okay? It's needlessly large. I mean, it's a 20-minute walk at the Denver Airport to where you turn the corner and go, damn, that's a long-ass walk. Oh, hell no, I cannot walk this. I wore the wrong shoes. You need some cross trainers in Denver Airport, Jack. I'm fat. I wore slip-ons so I didn't have to bend over at security. Fat guys know what I'm talking about. They're like, blister or bending over? Take the blister. I was like, I am not walking, because it was way down there, man. I mean, like, a long way. Like, I couldn't see the end. That's how far it was. And I'm like, oh, hell no. Black man with a golf cart! Black man with a golf cart! Hope you got this sumbitch charged all the way up. I want you breaking down halfway, Jack. Y'all, they picked me up at gate 88. Gate 31, Kansas State line. It's a big airport, Jack. Okay, they drop you off at this escalator, because you got to take the escalator down to a train to take another escalator up to baggage claim, okay? Way away, apparently. And I was unprepared for how high this escalator was, okay? It's one of those really super tall escalators that's scary, okay? And I'm like, I started leaning back for no reason. Because I know it's irrational. I know that the stairs gonna stay the same level the whole way down. There's no possibility. But as a fat man, I'm always scared that my old nemesis, gravity, might show up. And if I start to fall, that's 47 people dead, okay? I'm trying to save your life. Think about that. I'm a little superstitious, though. When we got down to the bottom, and by the way, it started to get warmer on the way down. I was like, y'all smell sulfur? Repent! Repent! Okay. At the bottom, it's a... there's the train, right? For me, I always like to get on the last car of the train and get in the back bench, okay? I like to sit down on the bench because I'm fat and I want to keep this much mass low, okay? In case they hit the brake hard. You know, I don't trust that little handle. That's all I'm saying. I don't trust that little handle. That can't stop the kid, okay? And I ain't strong enough to stop it either, okay? I mean, I have to be like tied to it or something. I mean, I would try to save your life, okay? But all you could get was like, oh, that's all I could do. I swear to God, that's it. Oh, if you hear a, oh, on a train at the airport, you better look out, son. I kill 7 people, get a 9-year-old stuck in my belly button. Hey, help, 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 help. I want the red Power Ranger, help, help. And so I'm sitting on the back bench and I'm thinking, you know, okay, all right, I'm on the back bench. I've got the whole train to myself. It's awesome, okay? And just about the door's about to close, 40 Chinese nationals came on the train with me. Now, let me preface this before I move any further. These were Chinese nationals. They're not your Chinese from San Francisco or around here, your Best Buy Chinese. These were bona fide Chinese. Spock haircut and all. Now, I'm not talking about anybody else out there that might be of Chinese descent. I don't know you. I also can't speak for everyone in China or the territories they occupy. I'm just talking about these 40 people that I interacted with in Denver Airport. They were the stinkiest, nastiest people I've ever met in my life. You don't know, you weren't there, okay? First of all, the whole train smells like bok choy and ass, okay? It's brutal. Brutal. It's like one big flatulent train. And I'm like, oh God, that's in my nose. Oh. Y'all, they had a cooked duck hanging on the outside of their luggage, unwrapped, like it was a travel pillow. Had hair on it, lint. That duck eye was looking at me, the beak was open. Creepy! Now, friends, if you were gonna travel halfway around the world with some cooked poultry, you'd wrap it up into some aluminum foil, wouldn't you? Right? Maybe a bread bag, something? Not these dirty bastards. They just left it out there. Oh, I think it was about to turn, too. So I got that nasty duck smell. I got bok-chewing ass rock in their house. And then those sons of bitches don't cover their mouth when they cough. The dirty red bastard. This is all like, don't understand. They're in front of me. I'm on the back bench. The train is going forward. All I'm seeing is this huge cloud of SARS and bird flu and lead coming at me, just crawling all over my body. I feel the SARS and bird flu just creeping me out in slave labor. Ah! It's so dirty. Oh, my God. I wanted an SOS pad, like a steel wool, like get a Sally Field shower from Silkwood. Oh! Decontaminate me, please! Creepiest things ever happened to me. They were talking China talk, okay? What? Look, I don't know how you are. I don't know the difference between Mandarin and Cantonese. I don't know. But I do know that I own Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon on DVD, and I can recognize some damn China talk when I hear it. So they was talking China talk, right? And the same coffee, all right, you know, it's weird, you know? Ugh. Oh, coffee, he, something came out of his mouth. Hit another Chinaman in the face. And all that other Chinaman did was this. That was so not would be my reaction. And by the way, just so you know, it wasn't no white spit that's really round like your grandmama used to spit on you once in a while. You know, that you see over here in the corner and work its way to the middle, then shoot out at you. You're like, oh. Oh, where is grandmama spin? I mean, come on, we're family. No, this had some color to it. And it, yes, it looked like a chewed up gummy bear. Yes, I was there. You cannot be possibly more grossed out than me. Bok choy ass, duck eye looking at me. I about vomited in my mouth. Oh, he did. Yeah. That's how it went down. Like, hing da. I'd be like, ah! I'd be pouring gas over my body like a Buddhist monk protest in Tibet. Whole train would smell like fajitas. Dirty bird flu-y month. Ooh. Finally, the train pulls into the station. We get off the Tuberculosis Express. Right there, I would have paid $300 for a Purell shower. Just bathe me in Purell. Woo! But you're not done at Denver Airport just because you get to the end of the train. Oh, no, now you got to find your bags. So you go up, all right, and there's this huge tote board. And I don't know if they changed it now, okay, but then it wasn't alphabetically from city of origin, okay? It was as it landed, okay, is how they rated your baggage claim, all right? But if you're fat and you take forever to get the baggage claim, like, I don't know, me, all right? You lose your city, okay? You don't know where your baggage claim is. You're like, look at this huge Family Feud tote board, and you're really? Show me Nashville! All right, baggage claim 92. Where am I at? 6. Black man with a golf cart. Black man with a golf cart. What I really like about doing these last couple jokes where I'm talking about my wife being a Jew broad or, you know, getting Mexicans to clean the house or a black man get your golf cart or a Chinese. It's so fun, as me as a performer, to watch all of the white people look around the room and try to locate the nearest minority that I'm talking about. Oh, okay, the black guy's laughing. I guess it's okay. I guess I can laugh. Calm down, crackers. Calm down. You need to know this, if you don't already. I am racially insensitive. I am culturally controversial. That is what I do, okay? I am not politically correct, and I wear that with pride. I make no apologies. I'm bombastic, I'm ostentatious, and I could give a fat baby's dick if you don't like me. So save your emails. Save your emails. I don't care. I'm right. If you just look around tonight, you'll see a very, very mixed racially group of people here, okay? We got all shades of brown, okay? We got white, black, brown, okay? We got every religion here. We got it all, okay? All right? And it's awesome, all right? And I need that. As a performer, I need that, okay? Because if I have a crowd of all white people, I'm gonna bomb. Bad. Bad. Because white people need minorities to let them know it's okay to laugh. They feel so much guilt. So before I move any further in my hilarious comedy show, I'd like a favor, friends. I'd like all the white folks to please look around the room and locate your nearest black person, please. Go ahead. Go ahead, take time, look around. If you ain't got no black folks near you, a Puerto Rican would do in a pinch. That's all you got. Everybody got somebody? All right. That's your go-to person, okay? All right? You gotta be looking at that person and making sure it's okay, all right? And black folks, y'all have a responsibility. You gotta laugh, okay? If it's funny, laugh, all right? Because like, white people are looking for you for direction, making sure it's okay. Now, come on now. This was never more evident than a couple years ago, I was playing West Palm Beach, Florida. I had a club there. And West Palm Beach, Florida is one of the whitest places on earth, east of 95, okay? Now, east of Highway 95, completely white, okay? It's so white, the sky caps at the airport are white, okay? You land in West Palm, you're like, damn, how many supervisors they need? How much you tip a supervisor? That's gonna be expensive. I said this joke, and because there's no white people there to laugh, I ate it. Oh my God. It was so horrible. And this is the joke that started the bombing. Nothing wrong with the joke, pretty good joke. I said, if you see a fat white girl smoking cools, wait a second. There'll be a half black baby come right around the corner. And by the way, if you're white and you weren't laughing hard at that joke, you really didn't bother to locate your nearest black person, did you? So whose fault is it, damn it? I don't like that joke. Well, you didn't have a black person near you. My favorite reaction to that joke is always from black women. It's not even a laugh. It's like, mm-hmm. Yes. Take us to the mountain, fat man. Mm-hmm. Lord, Lord, Lord. I'm not politically correct. I'm not. I refuse to call anybody a blank American. I find that offensive. I think people are, I don't like to classify anybody as anything other than American if they're a citizen of our great nation, you know, and anybody else, they're foreigners. And it kind of works for me that way. I really like it. The big three that political correct people hang on to are African American, Mexican American, or Asian American, okay? Let's start with the big one, African American, all right? Okay. We got black people here. Any of y'all been to Africa? Where? Preach. Okay. Kumale, yeah, yo, Zuma. All right. You might be African American. The rest of these people are black. Most white people have never been to Africa. They have no identity with that. They're not of Africa. They're of the States, okay? And why don't they name black folks after some place they've been, like Compton Americans or Detroit Americans or Swap Meet American, Barbecue Stand on the Side of the Road American, something black people have been. I didn't realize this was a problem, okay, until me and my buddy Taquan were hanging out. Now, Taquan is really dark, like way blacker than you, homie. I'm talking Amistad black, okay? Like Sierra Leone black. Like walk outside at night, close his eyes, he'll disappear black. You know what I'm saying? Like don't live between Taquan and midnight, it's 11:59, you understand? Dark. And me and T are good buddies, okay? I mean, we crack on each other. I make black jokes at him, he makes fat jokes at me. Then we smoke weed and gotta laugh a lot, okay? Watch TV and movies and stuff like that and hang out. That's what friends do, right? And so T and I were sitting on my couch, right? And we were watching CNN, and they had Sharpton up there talking about how African Americans are being mistreated and all, and African American this. And by the way, I call Sharpton, I don't say Reverend, because I ain't never seen him in church. Sorry. Same reason I won't call somebody Colonel unless I see they're in the military, you know what I mean? You gotta earn it, player. You gotta earn it. Anyway. So Sharpton was up there, and he's talking about African-American this, African-American that, all right? And I turned to Taquan, I'm like, damn, man, I don't never call you African-American. He goes, because I ain't, player. I'm like, for real? What's the difference? Well, African-Americans are usually light-skinned brothers who are mad at the world because everybody talks Spanish to them thinking they're Puerto Rican. I had no idea. He's like, yeah, that's why I'm black. I'm like, hell yeah, you are. You're dark as night, son. I thought there was a cave sitting on my couch. Damn. T, I can sprinkle salt on you. Look like deep space, player. Fool, you're a screensaver. Ah! He's like, oh, you making fun of me, huh? Mm-hmm. I tell you, I ain't as dark as the shadow you're casting from that big-ass gut of yours. When was the last time you saw your junk, Ralphie, mate? And I'm like, all right, man, that hurt. Especially when I saw it last night in the reflection of your mama's forehead. Bye! Someplace else and now you're here, you could be a blank American. Like if you're born in Mexico and now you're here, you're Mexican American. Everybody else is just a Mexican, okay? You're not Hispanic, Latino, Chicano, the brown guy that mows our yard, none of that crap. You're just a Mexican. It's cool. Mexicans are cool, man. Always tan. I tell you, y'all are green, not brown, son. Y'all are ahead of the jump when it comes to carpooling. Ahead of the jump. Like, where are the Mexicans at? In here. Mexicans? Two carloads right there. They are carbon neutral, Jack. Carbon neutral. My buddy Kevin Rodriguez is a little touchy about this subject, right? And he said, I'm like, man, these Mexicans today, boy, they be doing everything, Jack. And he's like, Mexicans? That's racist, man. I'm Mexican-American. I'm like, for real, Kev? What part of Mexico are you from? He says, Chicago. Kev, man. Look, Kev gets real touchy when you talk about anything Mexican, okay? And more I know that I'm a comedian, the more I'm gonna turn it up and bug him just because it's hilarious. But, I mean, why does he get so mad anyway, okay? He was born in Chicago. His first name is Kevin, okay? That's not exactly La Raza, you know what I'm saying? I mean, y'all never rented any Zorro movie, had anybody say, Miyama Kevin, okay? He don't speak Spanish. He runs a restaurant in Richmond, Virginia, and he can't talk to half his kitchen staff. And he's touchy with me. Okay, fine, Kevin. He was picking me up for some lunch. I don't know, y'all in the back are going, ah, typical fat guy, lunch. It was first lunch, as we call it. I get in the car, and we're driving away from the hotel, and Kevin's like, dude, how did you sleep? And I'm like, good, till that Mexican maid came in and woke me the hell up. Oh, God, that's messed up. And I'm like, I know, right? I told that lady, Cielo Puerta, she came on in. By the way, Cielo Puerta, for those dum-dums of y'all who took French in high school, that means close the door, okay? And by the way, if you took French in high school, I hope you get stabbed at a taco truck in 3 years. That's for real. Stupid white people taking French. What use is that? Oh yeah, every year millions of French people sneak into the country. Anyway, Kevin goes, dude, how do you know she was Mexican? And I'm like, because she's the maid. And he's like, oh my God, dude, I can't believe we're friends. Oh my, that's the most racist thing I've ever heard in my life. She's Mexican because she's a maid, or she's a maid because then she's instantly Mexican? Why, how do you know? She was wearing a big sombrero and a serape with a gun belt and bullets and everything, and I'm waving a Mexican flag, Viva Mexico, Viva Mexico, and kicking a soccer ball. I'm like, no. Oh, so she could have been Nicaraguan or Guatemalan or Honduran or Costa Rican or Panamanian or El Salvadoran. I'm like, yeah, Mexican. Look, folks, not for nothing. Chicken and rice is chicken and rice. Arroz con pollo is arroz con pollo, okay? The lines on a map don't mean nothing that some white people drew like 150 years ago, all right? Until every country south of Texas gets more than 3 TV stations, it's all Mexico, Jack. Sorry. I think easily the most offensive one, though, is Asian American, ladies and gentlemen. Asian American, probably the most offensive to the race and to America in general. Not the people, just the name, the politically correct name, Asian American. How do you determine, ladies and gentlemen, without hypocrisy, that someone might be, I don't know, Asian American? Is it their gratuitous use of electronics? No. Is it the large spoiler on the lowered Honda Civic? No. No. Pretty much, it's the eyes, right? So you don't say a Chinese or Korean Peninsula descent, you just lump them all as those are the only Asians that are out there. Asia's a mega continent. This is my problem with it. It goes from the Arctic Circle in the Ural Mountains in Russia down to Malaysia. So it goes from wider to me than darker than him, all right? All right, there's a lot of change. There's a billion people people in India that don't have the eyes, all right? But that's part of Asia. But we don't call them Asian American. We don't even call them Indian American, because too close to American Indian. You don't know if it's Ormagudges or woo 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 woo. You don't know. Is it Cochise or is it Kumar? I have no idea. I was calling for tech support. Now it's raining. I don't get it, dude. I don't get it. I think in this country, if you want to be truly politically correct, then the only people who can be called simply American are black people. I know, all you white folks from Texas are like, whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa, that's certainly not funny, fatty. That's right. It got real quiet in here real quick, didn't it? Think about it. Black people are the only people who did not want to come here. Okay, everybody else somewhere down the line, your people wanted to be here. That's why you're here. Not black people. And you were allowed to bring your language and your heritage and knowledge of where you're from and your religion. Okay, it was okay for y'all. Even Indians, they were allowed to have their own language and everything, okay? All right. Not black people. We conned them. That's what happened. Black people didn't want to come to this, to America. They were chilling in Africa, chilling. Didn't know how to make a boat bigger than a canoe. Then some sunburned white dude came up to y'all, started to talk a bunch of bull crap, passed out a couple pamphlets, and y'all was like, free cruise. For real? Hook a brother up, son. Yes, that's how it happened. You got conned, black people. Sorry, you got conned, okay? Y'all were innocent, trustworthy, naive, if you might say, unsophisticated, but happy and honest, okay? Just like the Indians. They got hoodwinked too. White people con people. That's what they do. That's what they do. I caught hell for this joke. I was in Boston, and a historical sociology major took great exception with this part of my act, okay? I didn't know they needed historical sociologists. But apparently they do. And yes, she was a waitress, because that's what they do to make money. Nothing wrong with being a waitress, okay. But you got your master's. Yeah, yeah, move on. And she's like, no, fatty, we did not con black people to come to this country. We caught black people and stole them and brought them here. That's how we did it. We caught black people. And I'm like, ma'am, not for nothing. All due respect, we can't catch black people now, okay? Sorry, ma'am. You're telling me some pilgrim-looking son of a bitch ran through the jungle in those patent leather, big buckle pilgrim shoes? He ran down Kunami, a Zulu warrior who can run 28 miles barefoot through lion country? I don't think so, ma'am. You can put your money on the guys from the cigar box. I'm gonna put my money on. A blank American until white people officially recognize themselves as European Americans. Sounds strange, doesn't it? I know, because all white people ever been their whole lives are either white or American, okay? They never had to qualify themselves. And the reason this really hits home with me is in 2003, I was in Iraq, and I was there as part of a USO mission to entertain our troops, men and women. I was unfortunate for them to be there. And I always figure if they're gonna be there, I should be there too. I was amazed as we were flying around in C-130s and doing combat landings and taking Black Hawks from Kirkuk to Tikrit and from Tikrit down to Baghdad, okay? And how we got shot at and mortar fired every night. Those people over there didn't wanna kill African Americans or Mexican Americans or Asian Americans or white Americans or European Americans or whatever blank American you wanna talk about. They were just really content with killing American. And if they didn't have a problem with it and make a differentiation, all right, I don't see why we should. They try to divide you. Come together. Come together. That's right, man. I mean, y'all a pretty metropolitan group of folks. You could probably take the change to European American. You probably could. But you tell some meth-making redneck from Katy, Texas, that he's now a European American. You better be doing it in your truck as you're driving by. Don't do it on his front porch. You won't make it off of it. And be like, what? Jimmy Jack, get my shotgun. I mean, we did try Caucasian for a while, didn't we, crackers? We tried Caucasian for a while. But nobody could spell it, so we went right back to white. It was like, C-A, car, car, car. White. I don't know why white folks think they're so superior anyway. White people the last 20 years have gone crazy. They lost their damn mind. And I know it's weird to see a white guy saying this, but it's true, okay? You can't give somebody a free pass because they share the same amount of pigment, okay? All right? If they're dumb, they're dumb, all right? White people are the only people in this nation that call themselves Jesus. They're the only ones who ever say they're Jesus, okay? And over the last 20 years, there's been like 4 or 5 people that have said they're Jesus, and they got a bunch of other white people to go, all right. How does that happen? David Koresh in Waco, okay? Said he was Jesus. Right? Yeah, said he was Jesus, right? Other white people, oh, sure, okay? He wore glasses. If you look in the book, I read the book, okay? You read the book, Jesus could cure the blind. I think he could handle astigmatism. That's all I'm saying. Right? The old bald dude who looked like the guy from Powder in San Diego, who was the cult leader, remember that guy? Who convinced a bunch of white people to commit suicide to go to a spaceship that was being hit by a comet to go to heaven? Oh, that's retarded. White people are like, okay, sure, I'm with it. Right here in West Texas, okay? The out there with the freak Mormons, okay? Like the crazy Mormons, okay? Like the sane Mormons, I know. And there's Mormons in here, you ain't supposed to be here. So take your little bicycle and head on out, son. Ring, 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 ring. Or pray real hard tomorrow. Lord, please forgive me for laughing and having a good time. He didn't say he was Jesus. He just said he was a prophet, okay? And all these goofy white people that say they're Jesus or a prophet of God, okay? They all just really want to bang teenage girls. Now, see, banging a teenage girl is like a CD player in a Ford Focus. It sounds good, but it's not. I'll be honest with you, I didn't want to bang a 14-year-old girl when I was 14. Ow, that hurts. I don't do that. Okay, just a little bit, just a tip. Ow, my mom's coming home. Oh my God. I haven't put it in yet, okay? Seriously. You know what? I'm just gonna go drop a batch. It's a lot easier to deal with than this, okay? And play Nintendo. Brutal. Mexicans, y'all never say you're Jesus, do you, Mexicans? I mean, you'll name your kid Jesus. All right, Mexicans, y'all do a mess up thing. Y'all see the Virgin Mary and everything, don't you? It's like, hey, pass the tortilla. Oh my God, Virgin Mary's in the tortilla! Black folks, y'all never say you're Jesus because black people don't put up with crazy, okay? They recognize crazy and spot it and get away from it, okay? Like if a dude walked up to a bunch of black guys standing on the corner and he's like, yo, son, I'm Jesus. Y'all need to worship me. And look, crackhead, you need to step out. Just because you got a big rock don't mean you can come around us. Get away from me, stinky. No, son, I'm Jesus. You can call me JC, player, JC. Crackhead, step off. No, son, let me heal you. Let me put my hands on you. Mother, bam! If he Jesus, he'll be back in 3 days. I like it, man. I like different races and finding out new things. I was recently in Florida. And I went and had some Cuban food. You ever had Cuban food? Yeah. Get in my mouth. So good. So good. Them empanadas. Oh. In my mouth. Little tip for you, though. Let them cool off. Yeah, apparently them Cuban boys deep fry them empanadas in lava, all right? Let empanada hit my mouth at 1100 Kelvin, y'all. My face was burning like somebody opened the ark. The reason I burned my mouth so bad is my brain and my heart were having a fight. My brain was like, get that piece of charcoal out of your mouth. My heart was like, what are you, a girl? Man up, son. You gonna spit that out because you're a bitch? Don't be a bitch, man up. That's right, my heart's gangster. That's how it rolls. I took the burning. I was like, I was eating it. I was trying to chew it to cool it off like this. And you know, and when you do that, there's never any water nearby, okay? Never, never. And so you swallow real fast thinking, oh, that'll cool it off. But it doesn't. You're like, oh, wow, I've never burned my esophagus before. That's a whole new thing. Right, it gets in your stomach and it's burning. You open your mouth and you hear bacon sizzling. You're like, ah! After the meal, they were like, hey, Ralphie, my boys, they were like, Ralphie, you want some Cuban coffee? Hell yeah. I like Cubans and I like coffee. I'll take me some Cuban coffee. And I didn't know how strong it was. If you ever had Cuban coffee, they bring in a little baby doll tea set cup of coffee, all right? And it's a little baby, it's less than an ounce, and it's equivalent to about 5 shots of espresso, apparently. Okay? I didn't know that. Nobody ever told me. It's very strong, okay? Everybody in South Florida knows it, or as I like to call it, North Cuba. All right, anyway. They are, this stuff is so potent, okay? They all know how strong it is. You take one, maybe half of one, and you're done, okay? For like 36 hours, all right? I didn't know that. That's South Florida math. Like, there's 28 grams in an ounce. There's 2.2 in a key, okay? It's South Florida math, all right? I didn't know that. And so when they brought it out to me, little baby doll tea set cup of coffee, I'm like, Diego! What the hell is this little baby doll tea set cup of coffee, Diego? I'm gonna need a whole cup. What, are y'all rationing because y'all from Cuba or something like that, Diego? There ain't no communist here, all right? Wolverine, tell your friend. I'm gonna need a whole cup of coffee, Diego. He was like, okay, man. How much would you like? And I was thinking to myself, you know, I drink those venti white mocha, non-fat, no whip from Starbucks's, okay, all right? And I love them, they're good, all right? And I have them sprinkling extra gay, so good. That extra gay is what makes it. I don't know if you had it. Ask for it. Pull up. There's a secret menu. Just go. Just give me the gayest drink y'all got, and you'll get what I got. I love it. So good. Mmm. But that's like 20 ounces, okay? So I'm thinking, just give me big as you got, all right? But leave some room for some cream. I like some cream in it. All right. Okay. It took them 25 minutes to brew up enough Cuban coffee to fill 16 ounces approximately, okay? Yeah, at a cost of $58, by the way. I found that out the hard way. That's a little sticker shock. I ain't never gonna bitch about $4.25 from the books. All right? And apparently this is close to 84 shots of espresso. I had no idea. I should've known something might be wrong when I added the cream and it didn't change color. That's a bad sign, isn't it? I drank that cup of coffee, it took me like 30 minutes. It was the most amazing cup of coffee I ever had in my life. Oh my God, for that 30 minutes, I could see into the future. It was amazing. I felt so alive. I put that cup of coffee down, crapped my pants. I filled my britches all the way up, Jack. I literally dropped it like it was hot. There wasn't even no prelude to it. There wasn't a, oh. Nope, just deuce. Or as they call it, dose. I shook for 98 hours. Please, Jesus, let me sleep. I just want to sleep, Jesus. Finally, one of my buddies gave me a bump of cocaine I could come off of that coffee. He said, sometimes you gotta fight fire with fire. So I was like, all right, let's go. Florida's a trip, though, man. I was in Florida last August. Lord, that's a mistake. It was a little hot. It was 105 and 100% humidity, and it wasn't raining. Yeah. That's hot, Jack. I walked outside. Oh, my God. Within like 30 seconds, my boobs smell like vinegar. The twins glued to my thigh. Every step. The bat wing all the way to the car. It was brutal. And the driver's like, Mr. May, you want to go to the hotel? No, I need to go to a pharmacy, son. Quickly. Went down that baby aisle. I got a big old thing of Johnson & Johnson cornstarch with aloe baby powder. That's how I roll. I'm old school. I don't use talc. That's ground up rock. That's a mineral, Jack. You got rock dust on your junk. Anyway, I had a big old pile, like a big old Scarface pile. About a quarter of a key in case there's any Dominicans here. Any Dominicans? All right. Quarter of a key. I don't want to lose nobody in translation, okay? And right there in the aisle, wasn't waiting for nobody, just, It was like a pitcher using the rosin bag between innings. Y'all remember the blizzard in the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer Christmas special that grounded Santa's sleigh on Christmas and almost stopped Christmas for kids all around the world? That blizzard? What's going on in my pants? Is that a top hat? Yes. I'm very much, you need to know this about me, pro-scrote. I believe in it. I think that if you're having a good sack day, nothing can faze you. And also, the opposite is true. If you're having a bad sack day, nothing good can happen. Okay, you can have a great day on paper and have a horrible day in reality because of your, you know, your junk, all right? Like, dude, you just got 5 out of 6 numbers on the lottery, dude. Yeah, go F yourself. My junk is killing me. Dude, man, my underwear's got my right nut in a Kimura headlock. And it's been tapping out, but it won't give in. I'll go you one step further. I'm starting a new trend, okay? After every time I come out of the shower, I take a little papaya body butter from the body shop and moisturize my sack. I try. It's like oil in your mitt. I stretch it out and work every nook and cranny. I know a lot of you guys are like, dude, that's a little heh heh heh. Whatever, fellas, scoff if you want to. I guarantee my junk to be up to 30% less wrinkled than yours. And that might be nice, huh, ma'am? Have a nice teenage package come at you once in a while. Instead of that old gray crown roll bag my man's toting back there. Ladies, you might appreciate it, right? Nice, that's right. That's why I do it, for you. I'm a giver. I was staying at the Seminole Hard Rock Casino in Fort Lauderdale. Beautiful, oh my God, beautiful. The first word being Seminole, though, yes, and them Indians. Yeah, they got their stuff together, Jack. Okay, I know, you know, that they're the only ones that didn't give in to the white man, but they got their stuff together, Jack. The Seminoles, what? Okay, like 15 years ago, all they could do was like wrestle alligators, sell cigarettes, and make meth. That's it. That's all they could do. Now they own the whole Hard Rock industry. They own hotels, casinos, restaurants all around the world. Reportedly, at this time, they make about approximately $324 million a month. Yeah, I don't know who the head of the tribe is. I think it's Chief Cha-Ching, okay? Take all the white people's money for the things they did to our country. Take all the white people's money. Those are the real words of that song. I don't know. It's a beautiful, beautiful casino. Beautiful, okay? And I went to check in, and they said something was wrong with my room, and it'd be like 30 minutes, and I could wait to the side, or I could just walk around. And I'm like, I'll just walk around. Take your time, but hurry up. And I was going to go play, but the slot machines are all confusing. I don't get them. They're like bingo slot machines, which I'd never heard of before. And but they were like, Mr. May, we have a card room. Would you like to go play some cards? Hell yeah. I'll play some cards. I like cards. I walked into this casino in Florida, midweek, midday, and I was easily the youngest person in there by 60 to 70 years. And they could have filmed Cocoon 3 in there, okay? The whole place smelled old. You know how old people be stinking? Like Noxzema and rose powder and pee and poop and dementia and with just a little hint of The Price is Right. Yo, loody, yo, loody, yo, loody, yo. It was like a Matlock convention in there, boy. Everybody. There was a dead man at my table, y'all, dead. Everybody like, oh, he got a good poker face. No, he's dead. I went heads up against this old dude who had this oxygen like this. I knew he didn't have a good hand, because every time he had a good hand, he turned his oxygen up. Like, ooh, I'm gonna need some more air for this one. I called him Skeletor. All right, Skeletor and I went heads up. This is the only good hand I had. I made money and left, okay? That's how you gotta do it. And it was, my first two cards were a pair of aces. I got the highest hand, I'm betting, but I'm not betting a lot. I want everybody to come around for the ride, all right? Let's get some money, all right? A couple people fold, me and Skeletor are still in it, all right? The flop comes up, it's an ace and a pair of eights. I now have a full house. The only hand possible that could beat me is four of a kind, which is eights, okay? Four eights, that's it, that's all I got, okay? I got this, I've got it, all right? Every time I bet, Skeletor comes over the top, okay? Like he's got the greatest hand of all time. I'm like, all right, Skeletor, call. Every card after that was just junk, okay? Eventually, it's just me and Skeletor. And then he takes his Crypt Keeper talons, I guess, okay? They're arthritic and large knuckles, and he pushes. And by the way, you know why old people get their hands look like this, okay? It's not like gang signs for old people. It's because they hold those bingo stompers, okay? That's why they get like 3 bingo stompers in each hand. They do it to themselves. Don't buy that crap. Get arthritis. You play too much bingo. That's old people carpal tunnel. I know, I see it. Can't fool me, old man. All right. But Skeletor, he pushes all his chips in. All in. Like he did something. Like, okay, Skeletor, I see how it is. I go in my wallet. Bam. All right, call. What you got? Rolls over 2 pair. 4s and 8s. Oh, Skeletor. Bam. That's a full house, isn't it? I guess I sunk your battleship, huh, Skeletor? I don't hear you boo-hooing, ooh, I can't afford my medicine. Look, if you had enough of a government check to come gambling, you damn sure had enough of a government check to lose some, all right? Sorry, boo-hoo. It was all in, all right? And you need to listen to more Kenny Rogers. That's what you need to do. You got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them. Know when to get on your little scooter and scoot away. But you went all in, player, so I am taking that IV stand with me, too. I cashed out my money, and I went back to get checked in at the Hard Rock, and they were like, Mr. May, what happened? A pipe burst in the room above yours and flooded your room, and we're all sold out of suites at that level. So we've taken the liberty, Mr. May, if it's okay with you, of upgrading one of our premier suites. Now, y'all don't know this about me, but I'm the king of getting something for nothing, okay? You know, my whole mentality growing up was if one dessert's good, then try to talk them into 2, and that's gonna be better. I think you see how that might have worked for me a couple of times. This is my motto growing up. If she'll touch it, she'll suck it, okay? That's how I lived that. You know, you just bring it out, you know, like you just be kissing a girl and just like you just go from like you barely starting to walk to whoa, there it is. Just touch it. Touch it. It's like a baby bunny. Touch it. Just touch it. Just pet the bunny just a little bit. Just now nuzzle the bunny. Just nuzzle a little bit. Now kiss the bunny, kiss it. Kiss the bunny, kiss it. Shh. No, I won't tell, kiss the bunny. Now suck that bunny. Suck that bunny now. I know, I'm going to hell with that one, I don't care. It's hilarious. So I'm trying to work the angles here to get some more free stuff, right? I've already upgraded my room to a quote-unquote premier suite, okay? Which I don't know what it is, all right? But I'm like, big suite, premier suite? Is that a bigger room? Yes, it's quite larger than the room you were scheduled to be in. Why are you putting me there? I don't want a bigger suite. I'm fat. I don't want to walk more, okay? I think I'll need some free movies to compensate for this crap. Maybe some room service. Kiss the bunny. Okay, Mr. May, we'll give you some room service and some free movies. Now suck that bunny. That's what it is. All right? We're like, yeah. All right, so I got free room service. But what I'm really thinking about is if it's a premier suite, then it's got to have a big bathtub. And I love taking a bath in a big old bathtub because I can't take a bath in a regular bathtub because I look like a loaf of bread. You know what I mean? I like taking a bath big, like an X. I just take a bath like an X. Just, I stand there till my junk floats up and break the surface of the water. That's how I know it's time to get out. It's like that turkey button on the turkey. It pops out when the turkey's done. My junk pops out, I'm done. All right, fellas, I ain't trying to drown nobody. I guess y'all's wrinkled enough. Come on. I guess I'll get you some papaya. We went into the suite, okay? It was easily 4,000 square feet, maybe more. Big, the biggest hotel room I've ever been in my life. My wing, okay, of the suite, the bathroom was almost as big as this stage, okay? Not quite as deep, but literally about to that curtain, okay, right there, the blue one, all right? That's how big it was, okay? You could drop a deuce in there and play the game of horseshoes at the same time. Regulation. This suite is amazing. And the bellman's showing me the whole thing. And as he's leaving, he's like, Mr. May, enjoy the suite. It was Anna Nicole Smith's. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, thanks for pooping in my mouth, Captain Creepy. You son of a bitch. I can't stay here now. This is the greatest place I've ever been, and I've got to leave. This sucks. I know you white people are like, what? Where are you leaving? Oh my God, that'd be so interesting. Oh my God. It's a historical place. Well, that's all shoots and ladders for you guys, but I was raised around black folks. I don't like ghostesses. And yeah, I said it right. Ask the black folks, they'll tell you. Yeah, there might be a couple of them. You don't know, player. Like, homie, if I told you somebody died in your chair last night, you switch chairs, wouldn't you, player? You're like, hell yeah. I thought that was cold. I'm out of this mother. Y'all need to get Jesus up in that theater or something. I can't stay here, okay? I can't, all right? It's creeping me out too much. I'm getting anxiety. I'm starting to sweat for no reason, okay? And I gotta leave. And my buddies are trying to talk me out of it. Like, dude, stay. It's the greatest suite you've ever stayed. You're gonna leave because you're scared? Oh my God. I'm like, dude, I'm not scared. It's just creepy. It's creepy. Somebody died here. I can't stay here. He's like, dude, you are such a scaredy cat. You're a puss, dude. You're just a puss because you're scared. I'm like, dude, I'm not scared of what? She's gonna come back and start to act? Ooh. Ooh. Trim spa. Then my buddy Billy Wayne was like, dude, we should get a Ouija board and try to contact her. And I'm like, bro, she couldn't spell when she was alive. And then I finished the rest of the joint, and I started giggling because I was thinking about it. You know, if you did contact her on the Ouija board, you probably think it was broke. You know, you'd be like, Anna, if you're there, give us a sign, girl. Tell me what you really, really want, Anna. Tell us what you really, really want, Anna. Oh, God, look, dude, it's moving. No, I'm not touching shit. R. X. Yep, that was a prescription pill joke, ladies and gentlemen. Prescription drugs kill. Weed does not. Look it up. Weed's never killed anybody, Jack. Sorry. You might choke on some Taco Bell, but that's all that's gonna happen. He didn't die because he was stoned. He was trying to get his fourth meal on. Tough year for white trash, though. White trash, but take it on the chin, you know? Anna Nicole Smith's passing, Britney Spears' meltdown. Tough year. I love watching what's happening to Britney Spears. I gotta be honest with you. I love it. I lap it up like homemade ice cream. Oh my God. Being from the South, that's one of the favorite things in the world is watch white trash revert to its original form, isn't it? When she shaved her head, I was like, is it my birthday? What? Ah! It just gets good. Mm-hmm. White trash, white trash, white trash. She does so much white trash things, but nobody ever calls her white trash but me. I mean, she married a dude in Vegas for 56 hours till she sobered up and got it a no. That's white trash. Made some babies and drink and smoke while you having them. That's white trash. Get divorced, give them to the husband. Don't go to court and fight for your babies. That's white trash. Don't ride them in the car seat or a booster seat or nothing. Just put them in the front lap or the front seat, okay? Like a mama's extra airbag, okay? That's white trash. This is white trash here. She was caught walking barefoot out of a gas station bathroom. Ooh! Ooh! Walk around with the black feet. Ow! Hammer toes, black footed, white trash. That's what Britney Spears is. That's dirty. But in Los Angeles, nobody calls her white trash. They call her bipolar or manic depressive. No, that's white trash. And in Texas, we call it like we see it. Bipolar, sorry, lady. You're white trash, bitch. Welcome to Sonic, you're on Tater Tots. We wouldn't put up with it, man. You know, as much as I love to see what's happening to Britney Spears, you know who really loves it? Black people. Black people love it. Cause they've been living with that Whitney Houston mess for like 15 years, huh, black people? 15 years, you're like, damn, if this ain't the craziest pop star in the damn industry. Mess around with Bobby Brown, fix his teeth, bitch. Damn, do something. That fool smiles and looks like Skittles pointing in every direction. His front tooth is like, it's northwest. Put the crack pipe down, Whitney. Damn. Hold on, Britney Spears did what? Ah! Happy days are here again. Hilarious. A lot of women, like my wife, boy, she got mad at Britney. She was caught with no panties on. That upset my wife. That's dirty. She's like, dirty. Walking around with no panties on. She's got children. What's gonna happen a couple years when those boys are on the internet with their friends and somebody goes, hey, you wanna see your mom's giner? You got a point, honey. But before you judge Britney, though, you might need to walk a mile in her heels, baby doll. Think about this. If your hooch smelled like Kevin Federline, you might want to air it out a little bit, too, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you, ladies? Wouldn't you? If your hooch smelled like a failed rap career in Bakersfield, California, wouldn't you want to air that son of a bitch out? You're like, woo, what is that smell? Smells like 7 tickets sold at the House of Blues on Sunset. That's right, girls. That douche ain't gonna take care of that. I'll tell you that right now. You're gonna need something with some cutting power, like Dawn. Get that rid of that lasagna grease in there or something. For my generation, I haven't had many times where I remember when I saw something, okay? You know, Challenger disaster, 9/11. Okay, when I remember what happened to me when I saw Britney Spears, for the, you know, the hooch for the first time, I was working with my pal Billy Wayne in Pittsburgh, and it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I kicked him out because I thought, you know, I might, you know, drop a batch to Charmed. Nobody watches Charmed. Alyssa Milano, hot as hell. I've been with her since Who's the Boss. That's how old school I am. I've been rocking it. She's hot. All you got is basic cable. I'm saying, thank you, TNT. Anyway, so I kicked him out, all right? And I got a knock on the door, okay? And it was another Law and Order, by the way, all right? Jerry Orbach does nothing for me, okay? And so it was a knock on the door, but wasn't it like a friendly knock? Or like, you know, hey, Chappelle? It was a bam, 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 like security. Hey, we know y'all smoking weed in there, and we ain't done it in 3 hours. We had the window open and had the towel by the door. We believe in Jesus. We're very respectable people. I look at the little peephole, and it's Billy Wayne all frustrated. And I'm like, I open the door. He comes in and asks me the strangest question anybody's ever asked me at the top of a conversation. Dude, have you seen Britney Spears' vagina? Like he left it in my room. I don't know. Let's look for it. Helen Billy Wayne? I didn't know what to say. It's the strangest question anybody's ever asked me. My only response was, No, and I haven't gotten two of the wishes from a genie. What are you talking about, man? And he's like, it's online. No. It took 12 seconds. Jiner on the screen. That is what you are. Pretty good monkey, too. I gotta give it up to her. I like that. I like a nice big monkey. That's how I roll. I'm old school. I do. I appreciate that. I like it. Mm-hmm. You know? I like a big peach with a little cashew up top. That's how I roll. I know, you little anorexic white boys. Y'all like that. Like that little skinny giant. It looks like it's holding its breath. There's a reason my favorite flavor of ice cream is Chunky Monkey. Hey! So, yeah. But cracks me up is there's a lot of women not laughing. I don't care. I do. I'll be honest with you. I like to look down at a hooch for the first time and go, what? That makes some good-ass cobbler right there. Mm-hmm. Cool, baby. But so many women are like, I bet it's... Like, you women get so catty when it comes to other women's genitalia. Like, if you don't like her, then you ain't gonna like it, right? Like, it's horrible. It's dirty, right? You women so mean. Other women's giners, y'all like, I bet it's a big old floppy one. I bet it looks like hound dog jowls, all black and frayed with spots of pink. Boo, 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 boo. You gotta go to that lonesome valley. Nobody can go for you. What we have here is a failure to communicate. Now I want you to know, I didn't do those jokes as a gratuitous vagina humor. Even though those jokes are strong enough to stand by themselves, the reason I did those jokes is so you could better visualize, therefore envision, what I'm about to tell you. Reportedly, according to the tabloids and multiple newspapers and papers around the world reported this, that while on tour, I don't know if it's true, it probably is not, but it just makes an important point, which is 5 years ago, while in Japan on tour, Britney was supposedly offered $1 million by a Japanese billionaire to sleep with him. $1 million. And she turned it down. 5 years later, same vagina, free on the internet. That's some depreciation right there, isn't it, girls? Literally, the bottom fell out of your bottom, didn't it, lady? Ladies, you reckon if you lost $400,000 of value out of your crotch, you'd be like, sell, 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 right? Not her. And what's funny is there's a lot of women right now going, good for Britney, good for her, good for her. That's awesome. I'm so glad she did that. I'm so glad that she had morals and stood up and would not be bought for any price. Good for her. That she didn't contribute to the objectification of women that we're more and we have more intrinsic value than what's between our legs and our mouth. We have minds and hearts and dreams. You girls are adorable. If you think that, you are just absolutely adorable. But I gotta be honest with you, in my heart of hearts, if you really think like that, I kinda think you're a dumb bitch. So, I'm sorry. I know. You're not used to having fat men talk at you like this and use such crass language and say these horrible, mean things to you, call you a dumb bitch and mean it, and I do. You're right, lady. I don't know who you are. You are an exception to the rule. You are right. You are right. You got more of an education than me, smart as a pan, all right? But I do know this, ladies, that the first step in recovery is acceptance. you might need to accept sometimes that you might be a dumb bitch about some things. So you can make progress. You can get motivated to make a change for the positive. Ladies, my point is that you've all been made to feel bad by a man somewhere down the road, right, ladies? Somewhere a man let you down. And that's why I tell women, if you're on the fence of being bisexual or lesbian or straight, and you're right there and you're bisexual now, just go be lesbian and be happy. Just go be happy. I don't even care, all right? Just go on, be lesbian, get men out of your life, get your liquor license on. I get it. Lesbians, I get it. I like lesbians so much, from 25 feet, I look just like one. That's how much I love lesbians. Trust me, the allure of vagina is not lost on me. I find it extremely intoxicating. I get it. Vagina's amazing. It's like the original honeycomb hideout. Why would you not want to be there? It's awesome. It's so mysterious down there, isn't it, fellas? With all the many hidden walls and trap doors. It's like a Goonies set, isn't it? You gotta play the piano to find the G-spot. Thank you, One-Eyed Willie. Rest of you women, if you're cursed with, you know, liking men, sorry, you're gonna have to come with the territory and know that we're gonna let you down somewhere down the road. Every man has taken advantage of a woman at least once or twice. Sorry. It's happened. That's what we do. And girls, if you think about it, you probably know what I'm talking about. A dude you met at a party who said he loved you, and this was love at first sight, and you gave him oral in the parking lot of in his Mitsubishi Eclipse, and it kicked you out. I thought it was true love, BB. I know a guy who's done that. How about a guy who got you drunk? Yeah, that's right, got you feeling weird. You know, like, woo, end of the night. And, you know, hoodwinked you, buffaloed you, fooled you into getting your legs put up and catching a stabbing. Yeah. I know somebody who might have done that. That's right. You've all been taken advantage of by a man somewhere down the line. And the next day, you woke up and you felt dirty, didn't you, girls? Just a little dirty, filthy little tramp, right? A filthy whore and the whole world was gonna know you're easy and you're a dirty, dirty little whore, right? Wouldn't those horrible feelings been easier to deal with a check for $1 million? Hell yeah, get paid, bitch! Don't be dumb, that's business! And ladies, just so you know, I'm not a hypocrite. I ain't asking you to do nothing that I ain't willing to do my damn self. $1 million? Shoot. I'd turn that little Japanese man out. He wouldn't even know how good he had it. For $1 million? Shoot. My brown eye have like 10 knuckles in there. That's what he'd be feeling. He wouldn't even know. I'd be like, Domi Arigato, Mr. Roboto. That ain't gay, that's business. Why not? Not like he's gonna hurt me or something. He Japanese. Ain't like I got Green Mile behind me. I think it's gonna be all right. I'm sorry, folks. I've had hot wings from Zanies in Nashville and draft beer that hurt my little back door a lot worse than that Japanese man could. That was 3 days of torture right there, Jack. I couldn't even wipe after like the first 3 hours. It was a dab. And yeah, there's some chapstick in my house you don't want no part of. All I'm saying is I'd take 24 hours of uncomfortable walking for $1 million. I gotta do this. Because the reason I came back to Texas to take this special wasn't because anybody wanted me to do it. I did it here because I love Texas. I love Texas in a lot of ways. This is where I came up as a comedian. This is where I wanted to be as a comedian. This is where I was raised. I love Texas, everything about it. I love it. It's a great melting pot. We got a lot of black, we got a lot of brown, we got a lot of white. And you know, somehow we all get along. And I like it like that. I mean, you even see black people at the rodeo in Houston, don't you? It's one of my favorite things is that rodeo, boy. I love it, man. You see everybody. You see Mexicans, black folks. Yeah, black people go to the rodeo in Texas. Ain't that something? Yeah, son. My favorite event at the rodeo, I don't know how y'all are, bull riding. All right? I love bull riding. And you never see a whole lot of fat guys do this, do you? I think it'd be a lot funnier of a sport if you could get, like, once a night, put a fat guy on a bull. It's like, now riding Satan's breath, the most dangerous bull on the circuit, all the way from Houston, Texas, Ralphie May. Another perfect score for Ralphie May. Folks, y'all been beautiful. Thank you so much. Austin, Texas. Thank you, everybody. Good night.